London, 1999. Mamma Mia, the smash hit musical, opened, and ABBA's iconic hits were once again drawing the crowds. Benny and Björn, the Swedish supergroup songwriters, were back on top.
There is no other musical in London with so many women in it. Two main characters
for a good
are women.
Reason.
Yes, and the director is a woman, the writer is a woman.
But where were ABBA's women? Agneta Falskog and Frida Lyngstad were nowhere to be seen. Agneta was one of the 1970s best-known women. But she turned her back on fame. And then one bad choice tore apart the privacy she craved.
Everything became public, which, of course, was why Agneta wanted to avoid most.
And Frida may have gone from orphan to princess, but 1999 was the year her life fell apart and she was alone once more.
It was a lot of guilt, and that made her depressed.
How did they come to be in such a dark place?
I'm too scared to leave the house.
Was it personal demons? Or was it ABBA?
You can't trust people. And that's the price you pay.
25 years before, the ABBA women had everything. In a band that sold 380 million albums.
They were gods.
Oh. Oh. Never seen anything like this.
This is the untold story of two different women. In the words of ABBA's close circle.
She said to me, as a mother, you always feel that you're at the wrong place.
And in the words of the women themselves.
Jag blir lätt stressad och jag är en väldigt orolig person också.
Och en obegriplig sorg.
One, an ordinary girl.
Is mommy.
Wanting an ordinary life. Unable to cope with the pace.
When it goes that fast, it's like a hurricane.
The other, ambitious and strong, yet plagued by depression and guilt.
I need to be in the studio, so you need to be at your dad's house.
Beneath that surface of pow, she has a vulnerability.
Two friends, two mothers.
You're their father.
You can't go on like this.
Both ill-equipped to deal with the explosion of fame.
Was a terrible mother, wasn't I?
Two women made ABBA one of the biggest bands of all time. But did ABBA destroy them?
I'm so sorry. It's very easy to fall apart, or you decide, I will survive.
Men enjoyed the limelight once again. It was a different story for the band's women. Agneta Falskog had shunned the limelight for a decade, living on a secluded island farm.
She said, I don't want too much noise and lots of people. I don't want to run out because everyone is hunting me.
But even here, she was not alone.
You can't be here.
Anna, please.
Anna, please.
Followed by one dangerous man.
You're not allowed here. Go away. I'll have you deported.
And Frida Lyngstad had lived a real-life rags-to-riches fairy tale.
I must ask Fritz to print my speech.
Frida, phone call for you. It's personal.
But by 1999, she'd suffered several devastating losses.
This is Frida.
Mm-hmm.
it was very turbulent because it all happened in one moment.
Everything she had sort of built up, her life sort of crumbled.
Living very separate lives, Agneta and Frida's fates were still intertwined. ABBA still haunted them. A few months after Mamma Mia opened, the band turned down a fortune to reform.
When you've been a part of something as big and as sensational as ABBA, that will affect every part of your life, even after the thing itself has ended. Decade after decade after decade, it's sort of reaching into the future and it's following you around everywhere you go. And that was obviously the way it was for Agneta and Frida.
How did they fall so low? That story starts 25 years before. 1974, ABBA burst onto the world stage with Waterloo. Four fresh-faced Swedes in flamboyant costumes win the Eurovision Song Contest.
The way they look made people remember them. In the 70s, everything should be different. Absolutely something new. Nothing is too wild.
Their now iconic look of platform shoes, jumpsuits and glitter made fans desperate to copy them.
I've known a lot of women who is through life said that when I was young, I tried to be Agneta. Yeah, and I was dark hair, so I have to be Frida.
In hits like Mamma Mia, 24-year-old Agneta and 29-year-old Frida stare confidently into camera in images that will be copied for generations. Close-ups of poses at right angles made videos like these ABBA's trademark.
They were very clean-cut, and maybe that's why they were so popular, because they didn't, like, bite the head off a bat or anything like that. There was no drugs, there was no alcohol.
To complete the fairy tale, ABBA were two romantic couples.
This is Bjorn and Agneta.
Right.
You were married.
Yeah, we are.
We still are.
In spite of this year.
Now, you were engaged.
Yes, we
are. Right.
Since you were still engaged.
Yeah, we are still engaged.
That's a long engagement.
She won't marry me.
She won't. Frida, why won't you marry him?
I'm too pretty.
Agneta was married to lyricist Bjorn Ulvaeus. They were already famous musicians in Sweden and met on a TV show. Frida was engaged to songwriter Benny Andersson. Before ABBA, she was a jazz singer and divorced mother of two. He was a Swedish pop star. Buoyed by their Eurovision success a year before and hit singles like SOS and Fernando, they went back into the studio.
Damn it. Still not work.
What the fuck?
Yeah, I know what you mean.
Both Frida and Agneta swore like troopers.
There would be, you know, minor explosions in the studio sometimes in a way that maybe you wouldn't see between producers and singers that weren't married.
Bjorn and Benny insisted on constant retakes.
We can't have no voices left.
The dynamic between the girls, they liked each other a lot. And they supported each other a lot.
We just need something different, you know, something new. Something you wouldn't understand.
Both girls are very strong-minded. If they didn't like something, they just said, no, this is not going to work, so no. Get out of here.
Oh, if you were a dancing queen, you'd definitely be older than 15. Maybe 17?
For 3 seconds and you know what song it is.
Its iconic chords got people moving.
In Dancing Queen, you can find everything that is ABBA. Energy, liveliness, the joy of singing.
And the video of their passionate vocal performance with a unique disco sound shows how they'd perfected the ABBA sound by 1976. It was a smash. The album Arrival sold over 6 million copies. By the end of the 70s, ABBA was Sweden's second biggest export after Volvo. Fans worldwide were desperate to see them in concert. But for Agneta, traveling posed a problem, leaving her and Bjorn's 4-year-old daughter, Linda, behind.
I knew that I had to do it. Sometimes you can't choose. And when we had this enormous success with ABBA, I missed my children.
I'm coming, darling, just a little bit.
But staying home was not an option.
Some people go to work 9 to 5, but if you go to work for 3 weeks, and then you're home for 2 days, and then next job is for 1 month, that's something else. I think most women can understand that if you have a baby at home, and very, very small kids, it's tough.
And the band weren't listening either. They seized on their success with their first full-scale tour.
Agneta can be scared sometimes of situations like this.
She couldn't possibly know the kind of frenzy, the kind of hysteria, the kind of madness that was waiting there.